Hariom, we are back for the next story in the story series where we are featuring the stories from the different Upanishads. And like I've been telling you earlier in the earlier stories also, the stories that appear in the Upanishads have in them a very deep message hidden many times. The story looks extremely simple, but the import or the message that it's trying to tell us is very profound. Sometimes just on the outer look of that story, we can't really get that message. But when a learned person, when someone who has studied the Upanishads actually tell it to us in that light, wow, we feel such a simple story and such a profound message, right? So now, since we're just taking the stories, we will do the story. The story is probably known to most of you. It's a very common story. And it's also there in our experience, day-to-day experience. But then the message that it gives is the highest message that is given to us as to how important it is to know who I am. This story features in the Brihadaranyaka Upanishad, and it is specifically given to explain a certain mantra which says that when you have known yourself, then that's all it is. All your sorrows are gone. Everything else comes to an end. You're done. So that is the import. Know yourself. Know who you are. So this story is called The Tenth Man. Does it ring a bell? I'm sure most of you have heard this story. In fact, I think it's also part of the Sanskrit text in some of the schools. So it is a very common story. Now the story goes like this. 10 people had, let's say friends, 10 friends had gone to the riverside. Now they got into the waters, they swam and they reached the other side, the other banks. And when they reached there, they suddenly felt that there was one person less. Somebody was missing. And they all said, oh, no, no, that can't be. Let's count ourselves. And each one counted. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. And there's one there, 9. That's it, just 9. What happened to the 10th one? Then the other person said, hey, you probably made a mistake in counting. Let me count. And he also started. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, and 9. You're right, man. There are only 9 of us. But when we started off, we were 10. Where is the 10th man? And suddenly they realized that the 10th man is lost. Some of them said, you know, maybe he drowned in the river while we were all swimming across and none of us ever realized it. And that was it. Everybody started crying. They started weeping and sobbing and started remembering, oh, we had such good times, the 10 of us, and now we're only 9 of us left. How will we ever face this? And we have to go back and tell the families that we've lost one member. All this, they were crying and lamenting about. They were all in deep sorrow. And there was one onlooker. He was standing there and watching these guys, saying, what are they up to? Because he saw them counting. And then he saw them, suddenly like starting to cry and wail and lament. Then he came and asked, excuse me, boys, do you have a problem? Is there some way I can help you? Then again they started crying and said, oh, you know, 10 of us had started off from the other bank and we swam across and we had no idea when one of us just drowned and now we are only 9 of us. How are we going to face this? That onlooker looked at them and said, hold on a minute. Let me count you guys. Said, all of you stand. So he started counting. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 and 10. Who is lost? Nobody is lost. Suddenly everybody stopped crying. And they looked at each other and said, "Oh, this man is a genius. How is it that when we counted, we all got only 9? You must be a genius, man. You found the 10th man. You found the 10th person amongst us. Oh, you must be so really, really great. We're so thankful to you." And all that. And that man just smiled and said, "Do you even know what happened?" So they say, "Ah, it doesn't matter. We're all together now. We are 10 of us. Our group is back to being 10. That onlooker said, "Wait a minute. Now you count yourselves." They said, "Why? You have already counted us." He said, "But you just count." So, okay. So started 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. And then the onlooker tapped the counter, the person who was counting, and said, 10. And then they all felt so foolish. They left themselves out. They counted everybody else. What else would happen? Do you think they were smart friends? No, right? They didn't know how to count basic. But you know, many times in life, this happens. We look at things around, we see people around, we see our lives on the outside. And then some things make us happy and some things make us sad. And so we're always in this sometimes sad, sometimes happy, sometimes sad, sometimes happy. So it's as though the world is, you know, making us dance with these emotions. And we are tossed about between this nice and not nice, happy and not happy, that we feel so tired. And we feel that this whole life is just, why is it so sorrowful and, you know. So the Upanishad is saying, if you leave yourself out and look at everything else, then the world is always a mixture of good and bad. You're always going to get a mix of joy and sorrow. But then you don't want sorrow. You want only joy, unlimited happiness for unlimited time. Isn't it? No conditions whatsoever. Unconditional happiness. Isn't that what you want? Of course, all of us will nod and say, yes, that's what we want. The Upanishad says, as long as you're looking outside, you are not going to find this unconditional happiness. Then where do we find this unconditional happiness? And the Upanishad goes on to declare, my child, that unconditional happiness cannot be found anywhere outside you, because it is not separate from you. It is not that you are happy, but you are happiness itself. It is not that you exist, but you are existence itself. It is not that you are aware of something. You are the very awareness itself. It's not easy to understand this. It's not easy to accept this. But when we have faith in the Shastras, when we have faith in the words of the Upanishads, and why should we have faith in the Upanishads? One is they are revelations got by the drashtas or the sages. In their seat of deep meditation. They are not words that came from their buddhi. It is not man-made. Right? So, there is the authenticity. When it has come from Bhagavan himself, he is impartial. So, whatever he gives out is right. Whatever he gives out is the best. Because he has no partiality. He has no personal interest in it. There's nothing he has to get out of it. So these messages are universal. It is for everybody and it has in them everybody's good. And it has the highest message what the purpose of a human birth is. So This was just a simple story. But until each man realized that he was the 10th man, the problem was not solved. Because even though the onlooker counted and showed that there are 10, when each one counted again, they found 9. Why? They had not realized that they had skipped counting themselves. It's always like that. Many things, especially the most important, are most of the times taken for granted. So the Upanishad says, don't take who you are so lightly. If somebody asks you who you are, you will say, I am so and so by name, or I am a man or a woman by gender, or I am a teenager, I'm a child, I'm an old woman, I'm a young man, based on age. Or you will say, I'm a scientist, a teacher, an engineer, a doctor, a historian, by profession. I am fat, I am thin, I'm tall, I'm short, by the structure of this physical body. Or you will say, I'm a very sensitive person. Or you will say, I'm very emotional based on the feelings. Or you'll say, I'm a very dull person. Nothing, enters this brain of mine. Or you'll say, I'm super intelligent. Tell me what you want me to understand and I will understand it like this. Based on the buddhi shakti. So, these are different ways we call ourselves as. We refer to ourselves as. But if you noticed, everything was in relation to something. Right? Now, even the 10th man, that qualification, why is each one the 10th man? It is only with reference to the 9 others, is it not? But each one is one. When they paid attention to the fact that they existed and then counted the 9, they would have never made a mistake because it was 9 and me 10. Or me 1 plus 9, 10. There would have never been room for confusion. So, this was the simple but profound story from the Brihadaranyaka Upanishad. I hope you found it interesting, even though it's a well-known story. I hope you enjoyed it. And this is one of my favorite stories. It has a lot of meaning hidden, and it's really worth sitting and thinking it over. All right, till we meet for the next story. Hari Om.